my presentation tonight is about the exile of the Acadian people from their homeland in Acadia in 1755 by the British. Acadia was a colony of New France, which made up the modern-day provinces of Nova Scotia, New Brunswick, and Harrison County in Northern Maine. This part of Northern Maine was the site of the first Acadian settlement in 1604, 3 years before the Jamestown settlement in 1607. This part of Maine is currently one of the largest Francophone areas of the America, in which 80% of the population still speaks French on a daily basis. The exile, known as le Grand Dérangement, or the Great Upheaval, as it's more commonly referred to in English, was a time replete with tragedy and human suffering for the Acadian people. The authorities who dispatched the deportation ships tried to scatter the Acadian people and destroy them so they would cease to exist as a people. Not by killing them, although thousands would die in the process, but by robbing them of their collective sense of themselves. The story of the Acadians is that of a distinct people and the fate in the diaspora in which they now live. It's as much a Canadian and North American narrative of great significance to the victims of the struggles of two empires. While most people today have a demarcated territory they can call their homeland, this isn't so for the Acadians. There's still a place today that can really be called Acadia, and like many other ethnic groups in the world still searching for a homeland, this is also true for the Acadians. We start our story in 1604 in western France, whence all Acadians came. The man in charge of the first Acadian adventure was a Protestant aristocrat by the name of Pierre de Bois-Démont. Now, Démont wasn't on the scene for very long, and as a Protestant, he could never fill the role of father figure to what was to become the great Catholic enterprise of New France. Hence the reason he's really only known to historians, while Samuel de Champlain is the most famous of all figures associated with New France. In 1604, he led an expedition of two ships from western France to Acadia, and his men landed on Ile Saint-Croix Island in present-day Maine. Now, the first winter on the island was a disaster for the colonists because the water surrounding the island froze, virtually cutting the men off from water transit and fishing. The next year, the men sailed up the Bay of Fundy, which they named Bay Francais, located right here on the map, and they settled in Port Royal, right here, which was founded by Champlain. At this location, the Mi'kmaq Indians of the Wabanaki Confederacy welcomed the newcomers, and their friendship with the Mi'kmaq was to prove crucial over the next century in their struggles with the British. Now, major efforts to colonize Acadia didn't come until the 1630s, and over the next couple of years, 300 migrants from 15 families from France made the voyage. Astonishing as it may seem, today's Acadian population is largely descended from these immigrants from France, and these were the true founders of Acadia, in which all Acadians can trace their lineage. And I have mine right here. I'm Acadian on my grandmother's side. Both of my paternal grandparents are from Acadia. This is my maternal grandfather's lineage, goes back to 1660, circa Nova Scotia, which at that time was Acadia. And my maternal grandmother's lineage, which is at home, goes back to 1636. Now, 1636 was an interesting year, and the reason I bring that up is because on April 1st of that year, the St. Jehan sailed out of the port of La Rochelle, France, into Acadia. Some historians have compared this voyage with that of the Mayflower, but too many people aboard the St. Jehan sailed back to France to make this journey a parallel. What is interesting to posterity, though, is that this is the only sailing of that period in which a complete passenger list has been preserved. Over the next couple of years and subsequent decades, there were more establishments founded along the Bay Francais, including the fertile farming settlement of Grand Pré. More on Grand Pré later. Now, over the next couple of years and well into the early 1700s, even up to the deportation in 1755, there were many colonial wars and skirmishes between the Acadians and the British. In 1710, after a brief respite, a British fleet seized the provincial capital of Port Royal, mentioned earlier, and they renamed this Annapolis Royal in honor of the Queen. At this time, at the war's conclusion in 1713, it was exceedingly harsh for the Acadians because they were required to pledge an oath to the British Crown and were also barred from the governmental process in the colony of Acadia. One clause that the Acadians wanted in this dreaded oath, or le serment, as the Acadians called it, was that they wanted to be free from taking up arms against their friends, the Mi'kmaq, or the French, in the event a future war broke out between the imperial powers. So finally, in 1749, the capital was shifted once again to Halifax. This was again 1749, and it was established along the channel to offset the Acadian communities across the channel. The British, in their conquest, their goal of imperial expansion, they decided that the Acadians really stood in their way. So their only solution was to deport all of the Acadians from the colony and transport them throughout the eastern seaboard colonies. In 1755, under the Bay of Fundy campaign, August 11th to be exact, General Lockton issued orders to deport all Acadians from Acadia and transport them on deportation ships throughout the eastern seaboard colonies. Now, these deportation ships were hired vessels from Boston, and they were refitted along the lines of slave ships. As one can imagine, the conditions aboard the ships were atrocious. There was no sanitation, no light, no ventilation, and the passengers were kept below deck in the foul holds. In a time before the conception of pluralism or minority rights, Le Grand Dérangement was a contemporary ethnic cleansing. 11,500 Acadians were deported in total and sent throughout the colonies. Interestingly, 731 refugees were sent here to Connecticut aboard six ships. The port of New London, Connecticut, took in more Acadian refugees than any other port in all of New England. At this time, once the Acadians were deported, their homes were then burned to the ground, and their properties, crop, and livestock were then destroyed. The goal was simple. The British didn't want there to be anything for the Acadians to return to in the event the Acadians tried in later years, which they eventually did. Now, under the Treaty of Paris, the deportation of the Acadians formally came to an end, as well as the Seven Years' War. At this time, we see a mass relocation of Acadian refugees throughout the colonies. The Spanish government then hired seven vessels to transport the Acadians from Nantes, France, to the Spanish colony of Louisiana. They settled in the southwestern part of the state, where these refugees came to be known as Cajuns, which we still call them today. Now, back to Grand Pré. The spotlight was shown on the Grand Pré deportation of its 2,200 residents by the epic poem in 1847 by Henry Wordsworth Longfellow titled Evangeline, the Tale of Acadie. This poem was based on historical sources, and it follows the fictional characters of Evangeline and Gabriel and their deportation from Grand Pré throughout the British colonies. Now, Evangeline and Gabriel were engaged to be married, and Evangeline spent almost her entire life searching for her Gabriel throughout the colonies, until in her later years, she became a nun. Well, one day, she was treating a sick and dying man when she realized that the man in her arms was her Gabriel. This poem has really helped to bolster Acadian nationalism and has been one of the most compelling symbols, if not the most compelling symbol, of Le Grand Dérangement. There's been other symbols of Le Grand Dérangement, such as the Acadian national flag seen here, which was established on Prince Edward Island in 1884 at the Second Acadian National Convention. The star is obviously a French tricolor representing the motherland. The color gold represents the papacy, and the star in the upper right-hand corner represents Our Lady of Assumption, patron saint of the Acadians. Now, also established at this convention in 1884 was the Acadian national anthem, Ave Maristella. And to this day, this is the only national anthem in the world that's still sung in Latin. Now, I'm just about to conclude my presentation, but I'm going to leave you a little bit of this playing in the background.
So if you double-click the flag, James?
Did you put it on your USB?
Up on top. It's on there. Because we made it work the last time.
I thought so.
If the song is not on your USB, then it's probably not going to play.
Okay, well, if anybody's interested, they can go on YouTube, and there's a plethora of information about the Acadians on YouTube. I've only really given you folks a brief overview. But really briefly, I just want to tell you, the Acadians today are uniquely and culturally different from the Quebecois and the Quebec province of Canada, because the Acadians in northern Maine and the Canadian Maritimes pretty much existed from the mid-1700s to the early 1900s in a vacuum. So they've retained, the Acadian French dialect has retained a lot of features that are more in common with 17th century French that was spoken in France. Now, in conclusion, despite the scorched earth policies the British used, Le Grand Dérangement was a monumental failure, and the determination of we Acadians to keep track of our families has defied all possible expectations. Thank you for your time. I've given you a brief overview. If you have any questions, I'm open for any questions you may have.
You
should have just had a pencil and just dropped it on the ground. Like, slam this.